conversation is part of a larger series that was created to bring awareness to issues that impact women globally. And I'm here to talk about an issue that I deeply care about, which is reproductive rights. It is my big honor, very excited to introduce Alexis McGill Johnson, who is the president and CEO of Planned Parenthood Federation of America.
Hey, Melissa, thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited for this conversation.
I can't believe that you even have time to sit and do this. What the whirlwind, which must be your everyday life and like the superhero work that you guys are doing, is it 24 hours?
It is 24 hours, but they do let me sleep sometimes, and we do it in shifts, right? So, you know, like I take off my cape, I pass it on to the next person, they put their cape on, you know, and then we sometimes COVID, dry clean, you know, it's kind of like rent the runway.
That's the visual image I have, like you're all like cartoons that are, no, I'll take care of it. Oh my God. Especially with COVID, I mean, it's already such a fight, which I'll never understand for, you know, reproductive rights and for just for women to be able to take care of themselves and make their own choices about their bodies, that it is sometimes I don't know. I'm like, are we still talking about this? I'm sure it's something you deal. I mean, obviously you're dealing with it every minute, but it's like, how many times do we have to ring that bell? Is it just a never ending conundrum?
It is. It is surprising how much you have to explain to people that we actually control our own bodies, right? In fact, Planned Parenthood was founded on the belief that we actually controlling our own bodies is the key to self-determination. It's the key to freedom. It's the key to imagination. And like the idea that we still have to continue to tell people that like actually controlling your body is a thing, it's exhausting. I mean, that's like 90% of the battle. And then, you know, the other part is just making sure that people have what they need and that the access is there so that they can find the, you know, access to healthcare when they need it near them in their own state.
Which is tricky. And I mean, it's so based on, it's your income, it's where you are, it's the color of your skin, it's based on so many things, which is just, it's insane. It's like everyone should get the same equal opportunity to make their own decisions. Do you think that most people that are fighting against Planned Parenthood, is it, and maybe this isn't a fair question, but I always wonder how much is actually like mustache twirling, like, I'll tell you what to do with your body, versus people that are just so inundated with misinformation and they don't know that it's like, it's Planned Parenthood, it does a million things to provide like quality healthcare and quality advice for women and men. Do you think there's some, not an exact ratio, but like, what do you feel like is the main thing?
Well, look, I mean, I think that the main thing is, you know, exactly what you were saying, right? Planned Parenthood was founded on this belief that we can control our own bodies. And that revolutionary idea means if you control your own body, you can actually control your own future. And, you know, I'd like to think that there was some, you know, clearly diabolical person enemy that we knew who was twirling their mustache and trying to think of a way to take away freedom. But I think the reality is that that the hierarchy around gender, the hierarchy around race, yeah, the things that we are fighting against and all the systems that prop up, you know, these folks who are coming for Planned Parenthood is really what we're fighting against, right? They don't understand that inside our health centers, we are providing quality, affordable sexual and reproductive health care and education. We do like something like 2.5 million patients every year. We've got 16 million supporters. We do STI testings, breast cancer screenings, birth control services, breast exams. I mean, all of these things that like help people literally just develop their own reproductive life plan. You know, it's insane that someone would want to spend this much time trying to fight and take away those resources from people in their own community.
Just to change the narrative, narrowing it down to this one topic, it's like, well, still so necessary and everyone gets to make that decision. I often think like why our bodies have become a political platform for politicians. I just always want to, which the irony is if I ever wanted to sit down and talk about my actual reproductive rights or my ovaries or my vagina, like I feel like the same politicians that want to control it sure don't want to talk about it. They'd be like, oh God, there's something about like, oh, we don't talk about lady parts. And I'm like, well, you sure spend a lot of time talking about what I can and can't do with them. I have two daughters. I went, Planned Parenthood was the only thing in my 20s in New York City. It was the only way I didn't have insurance. It was the only way I could take care of myself. It was the only way I could get birth control. It was the only way I could get actual checkups. I remember that was like the first time I was like, I'm an adult. I'm going in to actually like just do annual checkups. I mean, that felt, and it was the only place that I could afford to do that. And I remember fighting through people to get in there. And I just thought like, going for my annual checkup, why are you screaming at me? And I was like, oh, they're troubled. But I just pushed past them and kept going in. But it is an amazing thing that it's like this platform that they've chosen to shine the light on. It's so often where I'm like, I would love to talk about, like, if you walked into someone else's house, it's like, I'm going to tell you what to do with your penis today. They'd be like, oh my, like what? That's crazy. But when you flip it, sometimes what I think people are like, they have this narrow explanation of the narrative. And I'm like, if we changed it to that, if you went to a woman that is not pro reproductive rights and you said, well, I'm going to tell you what you can do, there would be such outrage, but it doesn't,
they would feel like it's about control, right? I mean, like essentially like that person coming in and saying, I'm going to tell you what you can do with your penis, your vagina, your body, your hormones, whatever. They're telling you, I can control you and you will have to listen to me. And I think that's what people have been, you know, rising up across the globe around, right? I mean, from Argentina to Ireland to like, you know, to South Carolina, to Texas, people are saying like, no, actually, this is my body. You cannot control it. And, you know, you can build these policies based on your antiquated notions of how my body works and the ways in which, you know, you want to ignore the implications of your policy, but I'm still going to seek the service. So you're actually not having the intended effect either. So not only are you like willfully ignoring how my body works, you are also intentionally trying to control my body. And those two things are not going to, that's not a good recipe for you.
And it is a power struggle. It comes down to wanting to control women. Does the advancement and the progression in our White House still help, even though our Supreme Court has gone so haywire?
Oh, absolutely. Look, I mean, I think that we have a lot of opportunities with the Biden-Harris administration. We've already seen them, you know, within their first 10 days issuing really strong signals that they are not going to stand for the kind of reproductive bans and shenanigans that we've seen for the last 4 years, and really the harm that came from the previous administration. So we saw them reverse the global gag rule, which actually does impact kind of how care is provided and supported globally. We saw them start the process to undo the domestic gag rule, which was connected to Title X, which is our nation's largest family planning program. And you know, all of these bans, their commitment to repealing the Hyde Amendment, which bans access to using Medicaid, to basically using your own health insurance to pay for access to abortion. We've seen this administration kind of step in and signaling where they are going to push this conversation. But you're right? I mean, Melissa, when you look at what's happening in the states, you know, there are 30 states that are anti-women's health right now, right? There's 30 states where there are legislatures who have already developed somewhere near 200 bills, 50% of which are abortion bans. We saw just in South Carolina last week, a governor signing a bill. It was actually the Senate, state Senate bill number one, right? So their first priority in the middle of a pandemic was to ban abortion at 6 weeks. Like largely, I mean, I have two girls too. I didn't know I was pregnant with the second one until like at least 8 or 9 weeks.
I didn't either. I don't think most people do. That's literally like, it's an insane thing. It's like, you can't even make a choice. I know. And that's in the middle of a global pandemic, all this chaos, so many people needing help. The weather's going crazy, blah, 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 all this stuff. And they're like, we better keep women down. And then everybody that gets behind that, I'm just like, am I nuts? I don't think I'm nuts.
No, but you know, the thing is, like, it's not everybody behind them. That's the thing that I think is so frustrating to, like, understand here. Everybody's not behind them. You know, there's no state in the union where supporting, where people don't believe that Roe should be the law of the land, right? That controlling your ability to make a decision about whether or not you will carry a pregnancy to term is your decision. Everyone across the country, or rather every state across the country, that is the majority opinion. But what we have, you know, when you talk about those, like the people with the little mustaches who were kind of trying to come up with some diabolical plot, they have the plot that they have is they have created through rules changes and through gerrymandering an opportunity to control the state legislatures in those states. So they basically, like, this very small minority of a population has taken control of the levers of power in these states, in these 30 states. And in doing so, they are able to push an agenda that is completely out of step with where the majority of their own constituents are. You know, 77% of Americans believe that Roe should be the law of the land. So it does strike me that, you know, when we think about what's happening, that it is completely out of step with where the majority of people are.
Totally. And I've talked about this a lot. I talk about it with my two daughters. I talk about it with a lot of people, but I do think that there's a thing I often talk about. If you have a street corner and one person's on one corner, just screaming like, they're going to get you, you're all going to die. Like, that's really easy to get everyone to look. Person on the other corner being like, you're doing a great job. Like, you make the decision yourself. It's very hard when you're not being incredibly negative and kind of hate filled to be as loud, which is why what you do is so important, because you shine this bright light, because you can be as loud, you can be as forceful. It doesn't catch, sadly, the news blips. It's not as great of a tagline when it's like, everyone should control their own bodies. Like, it's not as splashy, even though it's like, it sure is for me. And there's always this thing of like, we need to shine the light on more of it, because our numbers are to the good.
Yeah.
And I think even what happened in the last election, I'm very hopeful that that was such a great learning moment. I hope for all people of all ages that your voice does matter. The numbers matter. You just have to show up and you have to activate. You can't just think it. You have to do it and get behind it. And I'm hoping this last election, really in all of these issues, it's like, in removing people from local politics and on different levels, like, I do think that this has given people kind of like an actual representation of like, oh, we can do it. It's possible.
Yes. No, I think so too. I mean, I definitely feel like what we saw in this election, you know, the millions of you know, this election was powered by young people, by people of color, by women, by folks who really were like, enough is enough. And they, you know, they organized, they got into their, you know, they went into their church registries, they went into their beauty salons, they went into their school board networks, right? And they did, like, and to me, that is like the power of, you know, the movement, right? Where, you know, the original tagline, as it were, was the personal is political. And I think people really understand how damn personal this is right now, and why politics is a really important way for us to engage, show that we understand the issues, and we understand that every time you elect someone, you are giving that person in a representative democracy the power to determine, you know, policies that affect you. And we've seen that on the national level, all the way down to the state level, our DAs, our school boards, whether or not we have access to sex education, you know, to areas where, you know, you're voting for your sheriff, right? And you wonder what is the work that person is going to be doing in enforcing some of these horrific laws. And I think that we need to be taking access to reproductive rights into all of these circles where decision-making is happening. Because they're affecting, you know, my girls are young. I mean, we're just, you know, starting these conversations around you know, how to control our bodies and how to, you know, stand up and advocate for ourselves in various settings. But exactly like right next to that conversation is also how you advocate and have those conversations, you know, publicly and actually engage in conversation with your friends so that your folks around you, you're surrounding yourselves with people who you can have honest conversations with about how these things affect you too.
And I think that is so important because there is still such a strange stigma about anything reproductive or female that like we shouldn't talk about it. Don't talk about it, girls. Like, you know, don't get pregnant. Great, let's have a really open, you know, conversation about that. And it's like, well, we don't want to do that. It's like you can't. It's such a strange thing. And I do find sometimes when I'm talking to my girls about it, because I'm very open and honest, anything they ask about, they're, you know, 11 and 13. So we're really, you know, I want them to be ahead of it, but it's tricky when they, you know, to tell them this is constantly being questioned. If you have the right to control your body, if you have the right to make decisions for yourself, and telling someone that at that age, that is grown up in a house that's, you know, very liberal and, we support everyone's independent rights. They're like trying to explain how that's just how it is at the moment is always really troubling. And I'm like, well, that's why you have to get involved. And it's a tricky conversation, but I try to talk about it as much as possible to take that taboo off of it, of like, you should be able to talk about it with whoever you want. It's your body. It's 50% of the population. And even though all these issues affect everyone, but I think the conversation it needs to open up and stop being like, you know, stop putting us on a fainting couch.
One of the ways that we can do that, and I would just love to ask you as, you know, as a cultural leader, as an influencer in thinking about the ways in which storytelling has become so important in this movement, like how do you see, you know, the kind of, you know, more and more movies, television shows that are featuring like these badass women, they are like living their authentic lives, including having an abortion, you know, in what ways do you think that, is that new for you? It feels new as a viewer. Is that new for you as someone who's in the industry to see these stories come up and really like champion a different culture for sexual and reproductive health?
I do. I think it's new for me as an actor, as a on that side of the world, and as a viewer, because you have to see the world you want to be in. My husband and I say that all the time. You have to see the diversity. You have to see the real world that you want to be in, which is the bumps, the bruises, the good, the bad, and real people. Everyone can't be cleaned up shiny. There's no issues, no problems. No one gets sick. No one has to. I'm like, first of all, it's boring. It's not real life. And I don't relate to any of it. You have to see people making decisions. I think the more you see it, the more it, you know, the more it normalizes, because it is normal. We've made something very normal, you know, something that affects, I would say one in three, one in four people.
Yes.
That they have to deal with, like considering an abortion, having an abortion, different reproductive rights, there's so many issues, and yet we act like it's one in a million. I'm like, you have to put it, it has to be shown in the things that we watch and enjoy to be like, that is something of a topic. I think that's the power sometimes of stories and books and movies and plays, that's like, it can bring up that conversation, which then leads to someone saying, I had that, or I know someone. And it's like, then you realize, well, so did everybody else. And this is all part of this is part of life. So trying to pretend and control it, where it's like the train's left the station. It's happening. We're living it. So trying to shove a moving train back in the station is a pretty dumb thing to do.
Yeah, exactly. No, and I could already see it. My girls are actually 8 and 11. And my 10-year-old, when she was 10, came to me and she said that she wanted to dye her hair because it was the only thing she could really change, because she wears uniforms to school and everything. And so I was like, that's not going to happen in our family. You know, we're not the dyeing hair kind. And she was like, Mommy, you tell me I can control my body and it's my right. And I'm advocating for my right to dye my hair. It's the one thing I can control. And, you know, you just realize how you know, when you do have the when you are having those conversations, when you are exposing them to really strong characters and leads and actually walking them through the nuances of decision making, that they are seeing that and they are feeling it and they are actually making those, internalizing how they will make their own decisions themselves. And so, you know, I've got pink ombre over here.
Yes, I've had the same conversation. I was like, sure, shave it all off, do whatever you want. I do think that if when that starts that young, it's also when someone on every other level of being a woman and in dealing with your own body, everything, it is like, you feel that you can speak up. You feel like you can advocate for yourself, which is God, so important. And when you see that happening in young women, it's everything. It means everything to me that they, like my girls, and you know, I hope that this whole generation coming up, I mean, there's still so much work to do, but they do advocate for themselves very differently. They do speak on topics that I think, you know, I was pretty bold as a kid, but I'm like, certain things I wouldn't talk about. And now I just think, to watch my girls like bring it up in conversation, I'm like, that taboo is chipping away because of you and Planned Parenthood, that you're, you know, you've got a mallet swinging 24 hours a day, but.
Yeah, no, I think that I feel like my mom grew up, you know, and still says at 80, you know, down there. And I'm like, I was like, what are you talking about? What is down there? I'm looking at the floor. But it is so important that, you know, the more that we normalize it in conversation, then, you know, I think about my girls when they are, you know, perhaps giving birth, you know, we have such a maternal mortality disparity in this country with women of color that, you know, they will actually be able to advocate for themselves. I mean, and you know, and explain that they understand how that impacts how the biases around maternal health show up in the hospital system. And I think that for me, the most empowering act for working at Planned Parenthood is to see somebody walk into a Planned Parenthood health center. You know, the agency that it takes to, and sometimes to walk through, you know, protesters.
Walking through those protesters and people screaming things at me, I thought, you don't know me. You don't know my story. You are not who, if I needed your help, you would not be there to help me make a informed decision. I'm going into Planned Parenthood like to care for myself. And it's like, it's between everyone's, you know, it's such a private choice. And yeah, the courage it takes to walk in, sadly, because it should be, I think it's expanding, but it still does take courage to just walk in and to work there. Yeah. We've talked so much about things kind of domestically for the US, but there has been such a drastic shift globally in places where I don't think we've seen such a big kind of step forward. So can you speak a little bit about that? Because it's very exciting what's happening all over.
It is unbelievable to witness, to see the plazas filled with young people, young women who are just like literally like marching for their lives, right? They are, you know, in Argentina, in Ireland, they are taking over, you know, centuries of very harsh controls over their bodies. And it's been amazing. And I think this year has really shown the power of grassroots movements, right? La Marea Verde in Argentina, like it's just given us so much to hope for. But we have a lot to learn from partners around the world. Planned Parenthood actually is in inherently global. You know, we have a Planned Parenthood global, our international arm actually turns 50 this year. We've been working with 100 local partners in 9 countries in Africa and Latin America. And so much of that work is working with on the ground leaders to spark and sustain progress, to support really the leading edge of the movement for sexual and reproductive health. And so, you know, it is so interesting to watch a country like Argentina take major steps forward around access to abortion, and then to know that we actually have 18 cases that are literally one step away from the Supreme Court in the US that could completely undermine or chip away and create really horrible laws with respect to Roe. And so I am hopeful by the young people because they are pushing that edge along, and you know, and hopefully their imagination will continue to push us.
I agree with that totally. I think the tenacity of youth coming in and demanding, because such a big part, it's not only the right, which I think they feel rightly so they deserve, they're asking for it, they're demanding it. And it's really access is a big issue, because it's not only can you, but do you, even if it's allowed in your area, can you physically get to it? Especially low income, people of color, LGBTQIA+, there's just so many people that it's like, know what they want, know they deserve it. But now it's like, we have to provide the actual access to it, which I think that movement from young people just demanding it and being kind of that grassroots of like, we will get you there. It's like, we know where to get it, and then it will just keep growing with them. And I find that very exciting to watch happen.
I totally agree. And I think, I mean, I don't know how you feel about this, but I do feel like it's also this recognition about how all of these systems are coming together. Like when we were growing up, we were taught so much about US exceptionalism and that, you know, the US, you know, leads in all of these various ways. And you see now in a global pandemic, in a global economic crisis, and the racial reckoning that has hit every, you know, nation, how systems come together, right? And that, it feels like that moment too.
I think it does too. Do you think COVID really kind of, it's, you know, it's the worst of it's such a terrible thing that's happened. Also, I think has been strangely such a unifying thing, because exactly what you're talking about is like America's democracy and all this stuff. And I'm like, I think we've gotten a real good look at what's actually in the cupboard. And the systemic racism and the constant keeping, you know, women's rights down, and it's, I think you have to see it and fully admit what it is and all your faults before you can possibly shake it off and try to get better. And I think that's happening with so many different groups of people that weren't that vocal before. And it's, you can't move forward until you like really acknowledge your past, as they say. And I think this COVID, if there is a bonus to have from this insane time, we have certainly had time to look at ourselves and see us for who we really are.
I think you're absolutely right. I think COVID has just laid bare the fact that racism is a public health crisis, right? That racism is a national security crisis. It's a, you know, democracy crisis. I think this last year, we have just seen how people whose very bodies we deemed as essential workers, right? We told them that, you know, regardless of what was happening, we needed them to show up, to turn the lights on, to get on that early bus, get on that train, drive the train in many cases, because we needed to keep our systems functioning, and we needed them to be there. And yet they weren't the ones who had the best healthcare. They weren't the ones who, you know, had the most available COVID test. And we saw how, you know, through a race lens, they really ended up being the ones who were more likely to die, more likely to experience the more challenging symptoms around COVID. And we played it off as if, you know, they had, it was also just because they had pre-existing conditions that created that, knowing full well that those pre-existing conditions had everything to do with their access to housing, their access to food, their access to healthcare, their access to transportation. And, you know, and we're in a moment now where, you know, where COVID from our lens has acted as an accelerant, right? It has completely disrupted healthcare as we know it. There have been opportunities for us to get to create more access to things like telehealth. But, you know, yeah, we also know that those aren't solutions for society writ large, that we do need to both address kind of our healthcare crisis and our race crisis at the same time, if we want to see people live long and healthy lives.
Absolutely. And it's all related. You can't unspin that web. Yep. And I think that's been a big thing of people are like race and inequality and health and progression and democracy and everything. It's like, it is all thrown into the same soup pot. So it's like, it all has to rise up together if we want to, you know, have any improvements at all. And I think that's, you know, it's a strange thing as we're now over a year into this COVID thing, but I'm like, I do think we'll look back and be like, it really shook us up and terribly, dangerously frightening. And also there's some good things that I hope we never go back to it. Cause I think we've shaken the foundation enough with this that I'm like, I think we needed something. Like one of my daughters actually said, like, maybe we needed COVID because nobody was listening. You had to like pick up the house and shake it because nobody was listening. And I was like, yeah, it's certainly been shaken.
Wow. So I mean, yes, absolutely. I think that's so powerful. When you think about bringing the next generation into power, I would love to just ask one quick question of you around the Super Kindness campaign and the work around your film Super Intelligence, because I think it's pretty special.
Well, it just it was something that just made sense. We were, you know, the movie is intrinsically, to me, kind, and what I think of humanity. I mean, I think people are, you know, we say in the movie, people are worth saving. You know, people are good. People want to do the right thing. People want to support other people. And it just felt, when we were putting this together, especially during COVID, we were like, I just hope that for an hour and a half, people could sit and watch it and forget their troubles, have a laugh, feel like we are all tethered. Like there is something about that reconnection to, it takes all of us. Like it takes all of, like when we remember that we're all tethered together, that things can really happen. So I just thought, it just seemed like 20 days, let's do it for 20 days. And 20 days of kindness was like, I was constantly reading and being re-inspired by all these people that, you know, always, but even through the pandemic, we're still running these amazing charitable giving organizations that were just still completely like, how do we help other people? What can we do to help? Which was so opposite every news story, every newspaper, every lead article that it was kind of what we talked about before. I wanted to shine that light and remind people that like, they may be really loud over there, but there's still a ton of people doing the right thing. And it was amazing. We raised, you know, I think all in total, maybe over $2 million for different charities. I don't know sports very well. I was going to say you played cleanup. I don't know if that's really a baseball term. I don't know, but you were our 20th because Planned Parenthood really looms large for me. I think it looms large because I'm the mother of two girls. It was there for me in my 20s. I know it's there for so many women. It fights the fight, even though it gets so much flack and so much hatred towards it. And I really hope, like, I look forward to that narrative changing when, you know, we can stop being bullied. I feel like Planned Parenthood is so bullied and all it's doing is helping people. And I think that's on the cusp of really shaking that off. And you can't just say ugly things about it and make it true, because they're not.
I think in an age of disinformation and misinformation, first, I just want to say thank you for lifting us up and all of our other partners before us, because it does take, in order to shift culture, it does take leaders, warriors like you, folks who are willing to step in, help normalize, to stop the stigma. That helps us shape policy. It helps us shape conversation. It helps us have conversations with everyday people, just so the bulb can go off in their head and they can say, oh yeah, I went to Planned Parenthood, or yeah, my cousin went to Planned Parenthood, or you know, yeah, my brother's there now, you know, like all of the ways in which we actually do normally experience it. If we can't lift it up into culture and to have those conversations, it makes it really hard to actually shift some of these bad rules and policies. So, you know, I'm just incredibly grateful that you would choose Planned Parenthood. You would have a conversation with me, because, you know, it's just chipping away at the crazy narratives that other people are trying to put forward. And it's like, you know, actually it's not true. We're friends. You can't make us mad at each other.
It's true. That is really it, isn't it? It's like, you can't make it something it's not. You can shout all you want. We'll just be a little louder. We'll just keep moving. We'll just keep moving it up. Yeah. I just want to say, it has been such an honor meeting you, and I thank you for me, everyone, my daughters, every man, woman, creature, koala. I'm in Australia, I had to say that. and just for everything you do, it means so much to me. And I really look forward to meeting you in person.
Same here. I can't wait till COVID ends. Thank you so much for all that you do in so many realms. And thank you so much for supporting Planned Parenthood. And enjoy your travels. And I look forward to connecting soon.